Welcome to the Dead Pixel Society podcast, the photo imaging industry's leading news source. Here's your host, Gary Peugeot.
The Dead Pixel Society podcast is brought to you by Media Clip, Advertech Printing, and Independent Photo Imagers.
Hello again and welcome to the Dead Pixel Society podcast. I'm your host, Gary Peugeot, and today we're joined by Kyle Mao, the CEO and owner of HireUA.com. Kyle is coming to us from Poland today. Hi, Kyle. How are you today?
Doing good. Thanks for having me on, Gary. I really appreciate it.
So you do not have a Polish accent.
I do not.
Where are you from? And how did you get started in the remote work business?
So I'm originally from California, and I was actually a very long time ago when I was 24 years old. I was an engineer. I'm almost 33 now. And I decided I did not really like the corporate job. So I quit a six-figure job, saved a few thousand dollars, and took a one-way ticket out to Eastern Europe, where I ultimately found a new home. And I've been out here pretty much ever since.
So what were you doing in this former job?
I was a computer systems engineer. So I was in charge of running data centers with the storage units. And when big companies had problems this data set's offline, they would call me.
At the middle of the night when you're trying to sleep.
Sometimes, yes. And then what actually really set me, I have to go be an entrepreneur, was I became an admin instead of an engineer. And I was working for a think tank for the government. And it was one of those situations where if I wanted to make a 5-minute change, I had to have 5 months of meetings. Mm-hmm. Just sitting at a desk all day. I couldn't do it. Mm-hmm. Just waiting for people to get their paperwork done. So I took a shot and thankfully it worked out.
So clearly one who works for a government think tank, the first thing they do when they go to Eastern Europe is start an olive oil company. I've seen that story over and over again. Tell me how you did it.
Well, actually, I started off as a blogger, just doing travel stuff, a little bit of dating advice, basically saying hey, people, maybe you want to move abroad. And then one of my readers from that blog, his name is Martin, he had a family olive oil orchard in Croatia and needed help with marketing. So I partnered with him. There's a bottle of it behind me here on the shelf. Although this is just an audio podcast, so you're not gonna be able to see it,
but you can plug it. Go ahead, plug it, plug.
Okay.
Do the plug.
Yep. Selloolive.com if you want to check it out. Basically, then a few years later, COVID happened. I was living in Ukraine and I ended up hiring someone as a personal assistant in Ukraine. And I kind of said, a lot of people have always gone to India and the Philippines to outsource overseas. Why is no one coming here? Because they're really sharp. They're really smart. Mm-hmm. And that's ultimately kind of how HireUA got started, was me just being on the ground there and seeing there was maybe an opportunity.
So what kind of companies are looking for remote work? I mean, you always hear it for programming and, call centers and, that sort of thing, but it can really be almost anything at this point with technology.
It really can. Last year, we signed a tire distribution company in Miami and we placed some people there. And that to me was this is a shop that sells tires locally in Miami, hiring logistics and operations managers 8 time zones away, and it's working. So mm-hmm. Like you said, technology has really changed the game that almost any business now, unless it's a retail storefront, really can become remote. But in even some of those, I've noticed there's dentist office, doctor's offices now where you walk in and there's an iMac, there's someone there who will check you in and that person's overseas and mm-hmm. they're just on the camera. So really there's almost no shortage of almost anyone can become a remote company these days, truly.
Obviously, those are either technical jobs or customer-facing jobs that can be done remotely. The way you structure the business, do you get a specific person, or is it there's a pool of people who are going to do this function? Because I think a lot of people who are looking at remote work wouldn't like a revolving door type thing, right? Where it's whoever mm-hmm. comes in that day. I'm thinking a call center. Can you have a dedicated person to fulfill a function when you're doing a remote position, for example? Let's say, for example, you're doing sales. Let's say you had a remote person doing cold calling. Could you make sure you get the same person?
What do you mean? So, we basically spec people based off of the role that they need. So a business right. comes to us and says, we need someone to manage our customers. So we would go out and find this very specific person.
Okay, that's what I mean. It's a very specific thing. It's not a... You know, like most people think of remote work, especially overseas. They think, you know, a call center, you're never going to get the same person twice, right?
Yeah, no. These are dedicated people. They've always got the same person coming. And they're usually small businesses. So when someone becomes a client success manager or a customer success manager, that person is then dedicated to whoever the clients are for that business. It's definitely not a revolving door. And I know exactly what you're talking about. Like every time you call a bank overseas, you call someone, you get someone, and then, you know, you get disconnected and you have to start all over, and you'll never, ever, ever have that same person again. Which I think has really made customer service is very difficult for a lot of people these days. It's very hard to get the help that you need when you call like a big corporation these days.
Yeah, because people still like to call and talk to people. I mean, yeah, there's this the AI chatbots and all that great stuff, but you know, there are a great number of people who just want to talk to a human being who can listen to them and get something done.
Yeah. And a lot of the problem too is that if it's ever any sensitive information, you just have to go round and round and round. And it's very difficult to get that help you need. And like you said, AI is not necessarily always a good substitute.
Now, you brought something up that's kind of interesting, sensitive information, right? Are there any legal or logistical issues with having to manage, like, let's say, you mentioned a dentist, right? So in patient files, right? That information going overseas, you know, HIPAA, is there HIPAA concerns there or anything like that?
We don't typically do placements like that. So we've done a couple like medical IT companies, and they had to set up separate access points for these people. Like there's basically a wall where there are people couldn't get into the other side of it because of HIPAA. So I don't know, because we don't really do positions like that. I don't know what the legality is as far as, you know, having someone right there, you know, that has access to that information. Certainly if you're a dentist or a doctor looking for an opportunity like that, then you need to, you know, go with someone who actually has those fail safes and, you know, do your research on that. But yeah, it certainly can be an issue. And the one thing I always tell people is like, at the end of the day, this person is overseas. And what are you going to do if they do something? You are not going to, for example, start a lawsuit, you know, in Ukraine. You're not going to hire a lawyer there. You're not going to be able to get this person to court. You know, it's the middle of a war going on there. And then, you know, how are you going to possibly collect damages? It's just not going to happen. And that's just kind of what I tell people. That's your trade-off, you know, to save a ton of money on hiring them is there is potentially a little bit more risk.
Right. That is a very balanced way of looking at it, right? Because I mean, you brought up the elephant in the room, which is you do this to save money. You
Oh
do
yeah,
this.
I
Yeah,
mean,
I mean, that's why you're doing it. What kind of cost savings can someone see typically? Let's say, for example, you know, let's say a customer service person, entry level here, let's say they're making $18, $19 an hour, you know, plus basic benefits. What kind of savings can we see there, like on a percentage basis?
typically, you would see savings of roughly 70 to 80% across the majority of positions. So, you know, customer service person, you're probably looking around $6 to $10 an hour. Kind of just depends. And the other thing, though, is that it's very expensive to hire, like in the United States now, because of the benefits and the, you know, 401k matching and insurance and everything else that has to be on top of that number. Whereas when you go abroad, you don't have to provide any of that. You know, if you decide to, great, it's a nice bonus, but you don't necessarily have to. So it typically comes out quite a bit cheaper. And I think what I've seen over the last few years is so many small business owners are struggling to just get people into jobs. And I
Well,
don't know if this
exactly.
is.
That's what I'm thinking, because I know, like in the industry I work in, the photo imaging industry, it's very, very difficult
I mean,
to
and
get people to just even, especially during
yeah.
crunch time, right? Now, can you do this temporarily, or is it a year-long contract? Because in the photo industry, we have seasonal work. You
Yeah.
know, we have heavy seasons, then not so heavy seasons.
So we typically try to put people into full-time roles. There are companies that will do more project-based, and we make exceptions. You know, we obviously are a business, we have to make money too. So if someone comes to us and says, "Hey, I only need this person for 3 months," and we know the score going in, then we can go to candidates. Like we might find someone who's just looking for part-time work, and we can just tell them, like, "Hey, this is a temporary gig. As long as you know the score, as long as you're good with it and everybody's happy, then, you know, we can make this work." But I think what a lot of people now, you know, in the businesses that you're talking about, is it's hard to get people to even show up to interviews in person. Like some of the local small businesses that are our clients are like half our people don't even show up to in-person interviews because all they're doing is checking the box on unemployment of, I applied for a job.
Right.
I didn't go to the interview. I applied, though, and that then gets them their next check in the mail, and they just do it all over and over again.
Or they accept the job and still don't show up, which you still hear stories of.
Hear that, too.
Which floors me to the umpteenth degree that someone actually go through the entire hiring process, be offered a position, and then not show up.
It's shocking. And I don't know if it's like a millennial thing. I mean, I am a millennial. I know a lot of people my age are just not as interested in like working that I've seen, like with my parents' generation, for example. Mm-hmm. It's something has like fallen off a little bit. Mm-hmm. I'm not really sure what it is. And I don't know if it can necessarily be fixed easily, which is why a lot of people I think are starting to look abroad, because they're like, I have no other option.
Right. Yeah. I mean, I think the first preference for people would be, you know, if you're running that Miami tire store, for example, I think they probably would have preferred to hire local people, right?
Of course. Yeah.
So, I mean, that's sort of their thing, right? We're your local Miami tire company. So let's talk a little bit, I mean, about the Ukraine itself. So you went there and you kind of saw what was the deciding factor that made you think, wow, these people are great for remote work? Was it the educational system or the culture? Or the language, or, you know, because I mean, I think they, you know, even though they do, there's a Ukraine language, I think they, you know, they do speak English very well there.
So it was a lot of different things. The big history is that they were a communist country for a long time, and the generation now has come up in a society that's mostly been improving over time since communism fell in 1991. So English, just generally bright, intelligent people, just self independent thinking, you know, self-analytical, able to tackle stuff on their own. And just generally a very bright society of very smart people, a lot of engineers, a lot of scientists. So when you have these opportunities with an American company like we place them with, they're making double or triple, maybe sometimes quadruple what they could actually make in Ukraine. So like a young 25-year-old person who's studied English their whole life, who maybe went to business school but doesn't want to leave their home in Ukraine or wants to stay in Europe, for them to be able to then work remotely on a flexible schedule and make four times a normal salary there, mm-hmm. is like everybody wins. So that's really what drew me a lot, though, was just general intelligence and mm-hmm. self-analytical, you know, self-independent thought thinking.
Okay. So obviously there's a bit of a kerfuffle happening there. How mm-hmm. has that impacted your day-to-day operation? Because I think most of my audience is North America. I do have quite a few Europeans who listen. But I'm just curious, like from a geography standpoint, you know, there's the eastern part of Ukraine. So, you know, typical don't know geography. How is that impacting? I mean, how many people do you have in your pool, for example?
Well, when it all kicked off, things was chaos, obviously. Like for months, it was just nothing but chaos. Since then, it's really stabilized. So a lot of people that we've placed, a lot of the candidates we source have moved out of Ukraine at this point. So they might be in Poland or the Czech Republic or Germany or you know, all these other different places. So those ones are very simple. You know, they're totally safe and stable. If they're still in Ukraine, which is a lot of more, say, technical positions like developers, because right now men cannot leave the country. So we have to say, like, do you have a generator? Do you have a Starlink hookup nearby? Like, what are your options for staying online if things go bad? And, you know, we actually have had a few people that have not shown up to work and we've never heard from again. You know, we don't know what happened to them. They could be something, you know, horrible could have happened. We're not sure. But for the most part, we've made sure now that everyone we place is in a stable situation where they're able to still function and do their work at a high level.
Now, let's talk a little bit about your customer base, right? The people who hire you. You know, you've got a couple hundred clients. You built this thing pretty fast in a relatively short time. Are they all over the world, or where are they? And how do you market the business other than appearing on very successful podcasts like this one?
It's a combination of a lot of things. So I would say 95% of our customers are American, you know, USA, and then the other 5% Canadian, UK, and Australia, but primarily American. As far as marketing, I was fortunate enough that I've had a very large blog and email list from my personal brand back when I was doing blogging for a long time. So that I was able to kind of catapult into some traction on LinkedIn, some traction on YouTube. So a lot of social media. Basically, I'd say it's about 50% of it, whether it's Twitter, YouTube, LinkedIn, and then also via cold email outreach. So basically just downloading lists of business owners, sending out some campaigns, and just seeing if they're interested. And then as the company has grown, huge word of mouth and referral kind of deals where, like, once, because what people are struggling so much to hire when they come to us, if we find them someone in 5 days and this person is just absolutely killing it for them, then they tell all their friends who are having the same problem. So like, once someone's come in, they've had a good success, if they know other business owners, like, everybody just funnels them our way, which makes it really easy. Obviously, it's really nice.
Stay with us, we'll be right back.
Photo retailers, energize your sales with ShareMe Chat, the proven texting platform. Using chat to text on your website keeps your customers connected and buying. See us at Pro and IPI to find out why dealers using ShareMe Chat close more sales without adding staff. Find out more at shareme.chat.
So let's talk a little bit about technology, since you have a technology background. You know, are you concerned for your business that some of the functions could be replaced by AI with some of these automated systems that are in place to do some customer service?
Some things definitely concern me. Like, for example, I was playing with Midjourney, which is the illustrating AI, making some thumbnails and stuff. And I'm like, holy cow, you know, I can sit here and give it one prompt and it spits out just this beautiful piece of work. So some things are absolutely terrifying, and I could absolutely see entire roles being shifted away. You know, in the McDonald's here in Poland, for example, there's more kiosks than employees now.
Right.
Like, you walk in, there's 30 kiosks where you can order your food, but there's only like three employees you can talk to. So I think there's always going to be a need for people to run those machines, but I do think that we're going to see more and more roles kind of just swallowed up by AI, because it is, it's faster, it's more reliable. Once
and it doesn't call in,
doesn't call in sick. Yeah. It's all about whether the models can learn properly, I think.
So
you can, you know, right now, if you go to ChatGPT and you say, like, write a blog post, like, most people can tell it's not a human that wrote it. The question is, can it be trained to become good enough?
Right.
And in that case, then a lot of people are going to be out of jobs.
Yeah. I mean, like, in the imaging industry, you know, there's a lot, we've been dealing with AI for quite a few years, actually, with some technology.
Okay.
To automatically create things. But it is, now that you've got the generative AI, which is what you're talking about, Midjourney, where you just put in a prompt and it creates something out of whole cloth. That's completely new. And like you said, it's not perfect, but it's
getting pretty, better every day.
It's getting better, and it's not going to stop. You know, it's not quite T1000 yet, but it's getting there. So no, I was just curious, because I think that is one of the things people talk about here in terms of employment, is what's going to happen with, you know, AI replacing some of these functions. I think it will replace certain entry level functions, right?
Yeah.
You know, like, if I need somebody to do some basic copywriting, I can just drop it into ChatGPT. And yeah, I'm not sure. Yes, I have to edit it and I have to clean it up and whatever, but it's going to get you 80% there. And I don't have to hire somebody to do that. But sounds to me like you're trying to get levels above that. Right. You're not doing entry level people. You're actually doing key employee type functions.
Yeah. I mean, that's what we try to do. Of course, we do basic entry level roles as well. We don't turn away those jobs. But yeah, we're trying to put high level people in. Most of the people we put in, you know, are, you know, full on master's degrees. Lots of them have many years of experience in a relevant industry. Like, it's high quality people, because it doesn't do us any good to place people who are just going to get fired and churn. You know, we make a lot of our money on the back end of having someone in a business for a long time. So we're incentivized to find the best people possible, because that's how we actually make our money.
Yeah. It's like the old, you want a long-term customer, so you make money over time, right? I mean, that's literally how employment agencies actually work, is they, you know, over time is it's not just the single placement. So tell me a little bit about how you find people to be part of your program. I mean, obviously there's some recruiting and word of mouth that happens there, and you have to vet people. That sounds like a process.
Yeah. I mean, I'm fortunate enough now, I've built out a whole team, so I don't do anything.
Do you outsource that? Are those people remote that you...
Yeah, my whole team is primarily Ukrainian. I've got a couple like salespeople in the U.S. because we don't really do sales positions, but everyone's Ukrainian. I've actually met the majority of them in person, but we're all kind of spread out over Europe. So we've got some people in the Netherlands, Germany, Slovakia, some people still in Ukraine. So they all work remotely and they handle everything from start to finish. So once, like, let's say, for example, someone goes to the site, books a call, and they decide to sign on with us. From there, we write up a full job description and it gets passed on to the recruiting and operations team, and they go out and they do their thing. So a lot of it is scouring the local boards and local groups. It's a closed off place. Like, you kind of have to have local connections, local language knowledge to be able to actually get your foot in the door and right. be able to understand that. Then we set up all the interviews. So the business owner, whoever it is, just has to show up and we take care of everything else. So they just show up. They might do five interviews in a row, and then they usually will hire someone and we get everything started from there.
Cool. So in the imaging industry, right, for example, some of the business that we work in, you know, they've been used to outsourcing, for example, image editing used to be outsourced, right? To mm-hmm. if you needed a picture edited, you'd drop it into a hot folder somewhere and somebody would pick it up and remotely work on it and drop it back. And so that function has been around for quite some time. So people are kind of used to doing that. I just wonder if, like, you know, sales and all those kind of things would be as effective. Sell me on that. I need a salesperson. I mean, can you detect an accent? Is you know, how does that work?
We don't do like full sales closers because it is difficult with the accent and we don't think it's a good fit. So we don't a closer. We will do like appointment setters. So for example, if someone books a call and you want to qualify them, we could place someone who would then like call them and say, hey, can you tell me a little bit about your business before you get on the call with so-and-so? So that's kind of how it works, but certainly some roles are tougher to do than others. I think sales is definitely one of them, but there are a lot of companies, you know, in the marketing spaces and the agency spaces that, I mean, they're doing everything remote and they're closing big deals with remote salespeople. I think people have gotten, you know, pretty used to, you know, being on a Zoom call to be sold something to, but yeah. like big exactly. enterprise deals, yeah. like no one's doing, you know, $10 million enterprise computer sales on Zoom, probably. Like, you're still going to probably go shake that person's hand.
Yeah.
They're going to wine and dine you. So I think that's never going to be within reach of remote outsourcing.
Okay. So you still need that Alec Baldwin always be closing guy.
You still need someone to go take them to the bar and get them drunk and write it off on the company dime. Exactly.
Cool. Yeah. I was just kind of curious because there are people who, you know, are trying to figure out where something like this might fit in their organization. And, you know, it's not going to replace, you know, the more experienced salespeople who are doing that kind of stuff. So are you interested in finding a pool of talent outside of Ukraine, or is it just something you've now, you know, love Ukraine? So that's the pool you're going to work with. So are you looking at other regions within Europe?
We've actually started expanding out to a lot of other countries in Europe, like Serbia, Macedonia, because we've found really good talent there. And I'm actually working on a software platform too, which is going to be a little bit more global. I think there's talented people like everywhere in the world. And then some of the more traditional outsourcing hubs like India and the Philippines, sometimes the problem is that there's such a high population of people. It's really just like looking through a needle in a haystack. Like, if you go to some of those job boards and you post a job, you'll get 1,000 applicants, which is just crazy. So I think Europe is a little more condensed, a little lower population levels, and, you know, very, very good talent, very, very good people, which makes it a little bit easier to actually find someone good.
So what's the most surprising placement you had? Like the one that was like, I don't know if we can find somebody, and then it happened.
I'd say the most surprising one, like signing clients, was like when the tire company came to us, when an anesthesiology clinic came to us. So those are some of the surprising ones where I'm like, you know, this is not a typical like internet marketing company that's always been remote. Like, these are people who are just so desperate for help. This is where they're looking to go. So I think that those are the most surprising ones as far as clients. And then when we placed an architect once, we were like, we don't know if we're going to do this or how it's really going to work. Are they going to actually... like, is this going to work with a London architecture firm and a Ukrainian guy? And it actually did. So that was probably the most surprising overall one. Architects worked remotely. I didn't know if we could find that, and team did it. They did a great job.
Good. Well, that's exciting. So where can people go to get more information about your company and to read your old travel blogs or to buy your olive oil?
Okay. So if you are a business owner looking for some help, go to hire-ua.com. And then I blog almost daily at kylemau.com. Mm-hmm. And if you check out the olive oil company, it's Selo, S-E-L-O, olive.com.
Awesome. Well, thank you, Kyle. It was great to meet you. Best.
Likewise, it was a pleasure.
Yeah. Best wishes for future success. If I ever make it out to Eastern Europe, I'm going to definitely check it out. Thank you.
Sounds good. Thank you. Thank you for having me. Appreciate it.
Thank you for listening to the Dead Pixel Society podcast. Read more great stories and sign up for the newsletter at www.thedeadpixelssociety.com.